Will you turn, please, to the book of Galatians, chapter 6. This will be the eighth sermon that I have preached in the book of Galatians. And next Sunday we will move to somewhere else. Galatians chapter 5, or chapter 6. You'll remember that our study of Galatians, that Paul has been frustrated at the churches in Galatia because many of them had turned from Christ and the cross back to keeping the law, such as the law of circumcision and keeping the Sabbath, washing their hands, and the Ten Commandments. Paul has been very strong in his feelings with words of reprimand about what they had done. They had turned from their faith in Christ and their freedom in Christ, and having been encouraged by some of the other Judaizers that it's okay to be saved, but you must continue to live by the law. And so Paul was very strong about that, and you and I are as well. But now he is going to say in this chapter that there are basically two dimensions to the Christian life: the vertical and the horizontal. The vertical has to do with our relationship with God. The horizontal has to do with our relationship with other people. Look at verse 1. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, you which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness. Notice he starts it with brethren. He is talking about the believers in the church at Galatia. And then he said, if any man, that is not gender, it is a generic term, meaning any man or any woman who is a Christian. So he said, brethren, if a man, watch this, be overtaken in a fault. The word here is taken from the Greek word, peirathmo, and it simply means a falling aside or a mishap or to stumble. It may not refer to a great sin, but it would be to an awful blunder. Now, with that then, what is to be done with the person who is overtaken in that fault? Look at the verse. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, you which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness. You that are spiritual. The emphasis is on that word. Now, if you are spiritual and you're dealing with someone who has been overtaken in a fault, you don't do it by criticizing, you don't do it by condemning, and you don't do it by ostracizing, but you restore through the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at the phrase, overtaken in a fault. It refers to being caught unawares in a blunder, not willful transgression. So it wasn't that they had killed somebody. It wasn't that they had stolen anything, but they simply were caught overtaken with a fault. And you know what? We can all identify with that. Not in a willful transgression, but in a blunder that probably within itself would not be wrong, But in the eyes of the world, in the eyes of the other Christians of the day, then they were overtaken in a fault. Now, you and I must remember also that when a person sins, he does not lose his salvation. If that were the case, we would all be lost. So these believers then had gotten caught in a situation that was not all that bad, but was not right in the eyes of other people. And so the word restore here, is a verb that means to set a broken bone. Now, let me preface that. The Lord Jesus walks through life with you and me. And when you and I stumble and fall, He does not fall. He is not afflicted. He picks us up, brushes us off, and tells us to go do it again without what we did that caused us to stumble. He didn't kick us out. He didn't criticize us. But he is there to love us, to pick us up, forgive us, and set us back on the road again, and said, go do it again, but go and be more effective with it. Now again, the word restore, as I said, means to set, it's a verb meaning to set a broken bone. Now if a believer falls and breaks a leg, what are you going to do? Are you going to walk off and leave him in pain? But God said, you who are spiritual, set the broken bone. Get him back on his feet again. And then do what Christ would do to us, that he brushes us off and gets us back on our feet and then moves us in a new direction. But look also, he said, do it in a spirit of meekness. Look at the verse again. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, you which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness. You do it with compassion and with all the love of Christ in your heart. But may I say to us, that if you are trying to restore a person, it is not easy, more especially if that person has developed an attitude or a spirit, and you've got this real desire to see them back in fellowship with God, and you're determined to do it with meekness and compassion and with all the love of Christ. It also takes a great deal of prayer and patience to restore such a one. Now, we have experienced that here. And others have experienced that in their life. Maybe it was a dear friend of yours, but they got sidetracked and wound up in the world, and they were not what they had once been, and so they needed to be restored. I would say to us, call that name in prayer a great deal of time. Spend time with God talking about that person, talking to that person about God, rather than just barging in and say, brother, listen, you're on the wrong track. You need to turn around. Don't do that. That is not the spirit of meekness. Meekness means that you go with compassion. Means that you go with the love of God in your heart. Now remember who he's writing to. He is writing to the church here that some of them had turned from God and from Christ and the cross. And so he is saying, you who are spiritual, reach out to those who have dropped aside, but do it with a spirit of meekness. In your definition, what does the word meekness mean? It could mean a lot of things to you and to me and to others as well. But Paul used the word meekness. To me, it means gentle. It means kindness. It means compassionate. And so Paul said, when a man is overtaken in a fault, whatever it was, you who are deeper in the Lord than he is, though you who are strong in your walk with the Lord, those of you who are spiritual, restore that person in the spirit of meekness. I shared with you back a few weeks ago about this dear friend of mine that I had led to the Lord, baptized him, and he became my prayer partner, my soul-winning partner. And I loved him, still do to this day. It was a great relationship. But after a number of years, something happened. There was not that spiritual feeling. There was not that camaraderie between us that had been. And I knew that something was wrong. And then he began to drift. He got fascinated with some other teachings, and he wanted to speak in tongues, and he just had this desire. He wanted to become a faith healer, and so we drifted apart, and I called him and I said, brother, listen, I want us to have lunch, and we did. And so I dumped my heart out to him. I said, brother, what has happened to you? Where have you fallen off track? He said, I haven't fallen off the track. And it got kind of heated as I picked out from the Word of God what I saw in his life. But at that moment, I was not able to convince him, even with all the love and the compassion and the Christ-like attitude of my life, I was not able to convince him. Now, even to this day, we're still friends, not what we used to be. I said to you that oftentimes we would go to South Dakota pheasant hunting. We would fish together. We'd play golf together. We'd pray together. But he needed to be restored from my perspective, from my meaning of the word restored. But I tried with all that I had, with all the meekness that I had, with all the compassion of my soul. I did not do it. Still have not done it. He is today in another denomination, speaking in tongues, healing, and that sort of thing. I'm not being critical of that. If that's what God has led some into, that is not for me. I do not see that in the Word of God. Now, notice it again. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, you which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness. Now, watch this. Consider thyself, lest thou also be tempted. Don't think for a moment that you are immune to doing what that person has done. Nor pointing your finger at that person who has made that mistake and blaming another believer for what is going on in that life. If you're going to be judgmental about another person, you will never be a restorer. If you're going to point out that person's problems with a critical spirit, you will drive that person farther and farther away with your attitude and your spirit. Listen, a bad attitude and a judgmental spirit is more damaging than what has happened. Let me say that again. It may have been wrong, but the person who is pointing out the problem with a bad attitude and a judgmental spirit is doing as much or more damage than the person that he is pointing out on what they are doing. I have long learned that the person who is the most critical of others has some deep-seated problems in their own life. Let me say that again. I have long since discovered that the person who is the most critical of others has some deep-seated problems in their own life. And that being the case, you cannot be a restorer. Because to be a restorer, there's got to be that warm, Christ-like spirit, that loving spirit, even to that person who has taken a wrong step. And I would say to you, through all of these years, 50 plus years of being a pastor, I have tried to be a restorer. I've not always been successful, as I shared with you. I have been successful at times. There was a man in our church. I too led him to the Lord, and baptized him. He became a deacon. He became a Sunday school teacher. All the church was involved in. He would have joined the WMU if they would let him. He wanted to get involved in everything. But he came to me one day and he said, "Pastor, I believe God's called me to preach." And so I said, "Well, let's talk about it, pray about it." So I agreed to pray with him, and he came back sometime later. He said, "There is no doubt that God has called me to preach." Our church ordained him. He already had his degree. He had gone back to the seminary, and he was pastoring a church in another state. And he called me to preach a revival for him. And while I was there, after the service one night, we sat down in the worship center, and he said, I need to talk. He said, "Let me talk and then you listen and then respond." And so he said, I'm enjoying the pastorate. I love people, but I have this tug at my heart that I want to join the military. And I want to go to OCS. And he said, "I know that you are a paratrooper." And he said, "I would like to be a paratrooper after I get out of OCS." I gave him my blessings. He said, "What do you think?" I said, "If that's what God wants you to do, you do it." So he did. He resigned his church, joined the military, and went airborne. In a very short amount of time, he had gone from second lieutenant to a captain. He was very capable. But in the midst of that, he drifted from the things that he had heard me preach and the things that I had taught. And that at that moment he had grabbed it up and had swallowed it and was living by it. But when he got in the military, there was not those with that commitment to the Lord that he had, and he drifted. His wife said, "Pastor, I'm worried about him." And she told me the story. And so I sat down and wrote him a letter. And I talked about the letter to the Ephesians, where the Christians there had turned their back on Christ and the cross and were doing things they should not have done. And I dumped my heart out to him. He wrote me back. And he said, "I will never forget you. Because you're the man that told me about Christ. You led me to pray the salvation prayer. I will never forget you. But my life has gone in a different direction. And I choose not to expound on it, but I want you to know that I'll always love you. I did not get the chance to try to be, to try to help him come back to the straight and the narrow, the teachings of the Word of God. He retired from the military, and I'm not sure where he is today, but it broke my heart. He was a pastor. He was in the Word of God. He was strong in his faith. And it's bad when a pastor can drift away and lose the teaching that he had. I wanted to be what Paul had talked about. I wanted to be a restorer, but I was not able to. And I tried to follow the verse, but it just didn't do. If you're going to be a restorer, pray a great deal about that person. Listen, talk more to God about that person than you talk to the person about God. Because the success will be how much you talk to God about the man over how much you talk to the man about God. So my desire is to this day to still be a restorer. And I would hope that you would have that desire as well. Well, look at verse 2. Bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. In Scripture, there are 11 different words that are translated by our English language for the word burden, which means that there are different kinds of burdens. There are some burdens that you can share. There are some burdens that you must bear and that you cannot share with anyone. All of us have burdens. All of us don't have wealth, but we have burdens. All of us do not have help, but we have burdens. All of us do not have talents, but we have burdens. We do not all have very much in common, but we all have burdens. There is the burden of grief. There is the burden of tragedy. There is the burden of sorrow. There is the burden of disappointment. There is the burden of family crisis. But in the midst of that burden, listen, God does not intend that you and I bear our burden alone. During those times that the burden is heavy in your life, call someone, call a dear saint of God, and share that burden with him or her, and ask that they pray for you. In a time of when the burden is heavy, you need somebody. You need a friend to stand with you. We need a friend to pray for us, to encourage us, and to allow you to share the feelings that you have. Now listen, maybe you are angry at God for this burden. Say it to that other child of God that you've asked to pray with you. As a matter of fact, you can make an extension of that. You can say to God, you can tell God all the bitterness that you've got in your heart. If you want to blame him, blame him. God already knows what's in your heart anyway, and whatever you're struggling with, just dump it out to God. God's not going to kick you out. God wants you to say to him what you believe and what you're struggling with. And so give it to him. Let him help you with that burden. You'll remember that Job had three friends who spent 7 days with him, not saying anything. They were just suffering with him. And so maybe you're sitting here now and you're carrying a heavy load, a burden. You need to share it with somebody, with another child of God. There will be those who will come to your rescue if you let them know. Don't bear it alone. Even Christ in the garden could not bear it alone. He prayed to his father and begged his father through tears and not to make him go to the cross. His sweat even became great drops of blood, pouring his heart out to his father. Don't carry that burden alone. You want to be a restorer. But maybe you've got a burden of your own. I don't know what it is, and I really don't want to know what it is. Over the years, I've had people come on the invitation and they say, Pastor, I'm struggling with this. I've got sin in my life. I want to tell you. And I said, No, I don't need to know. I just need to know that you're saying to me, Pastor, pray for me. I don't want you to tell me those things that are going on in your life. Just allow me to pray with you. Don't try to carry the burden alone. Call a dear saint of God. Call another child of God. And say, listen, I'm struggling. I want you to pray for me. Betsy, our pianist, walked through a real crisis. And the burden was heavy. And she asked our prayers, would you pray for me? You see, she had been teaching school at the same school for 22 years. But things happened. And she was forced to make a decision. And she said, pray for me. Pray for me for a job. She told me just a little while ago, she said, I go tomorrow to a new classroom. After 22 years, well, she shared that burden with those, the rest of us, and we prayed for her. Bill Savino, sitting up there in the soundboard, he is struggling even now with a heavy burden, and many of us have coveted to pray with him. His load is heavy. He's got that burden. But notice verse 2, he said, bear ye one another's burden. Don't carry that burden alone. Whatever you're struggling with, let it be known so that we can pray with you. Pray ye one for another, Christ said. When you, verse 2, bear one another's burdens, and when you do, you fulfill the law of Christ. In the garden, Christ knew that he could not bear that burden alone, and so he took it to his Father. Neither should you and I bear the burden alone, but that we would cry out to others for help. Many times in these years, I've had calls to say, Pastor, I'm struggling. Would you pray for me? I've got this heavy burden. The future's dark. The load is heavy. And I want you to pray for me. My son was in school down at Palm Beach Atlantic College. And he, years ago, and he called and he said, Dad, I need your prayers. I said, okay, I'll be praying for you. He said, no, I mean now. Pray for me now, here on the phone. So on the phone from Palm Beach Atlantic at the college and here in Orlando, I sent the prayer to God, and God answered in Palm Beach Atlantic College. If you've got a burden, don't be ashamed to ask someone to help you with it. Christ didn't carry his alone. He took it to the Father. Don't carry yours alone. Sit down and tell somebody about your struggles. Charlie and Frida called me not long ago. Their daughter was struggling. She had fell and knocked her shoulder out of socket, and she was having trouble, lost the feeling. And I said, will you pray for her? And I did. And continue to this day. God has not answered completely at this point. There's still some lingering problems. But they knew the burden was heavy, and they wanted somebody to pray with them. So look at what Paul said. Now remember, he's talking to those who have turned their backs on Christ and the cross. And he said to those who have broken away, and it's a burden to you, bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. What does all of this say to you and me? As you've listened, what has God said to you? Let me share with you three things as I close that I believe God is saying to us. Number one, don't rush to judgment. Don't rush to judgment. Number two, show the love of Christ to that person who fell. Show the love of Christ to that person who fell. That one that was overtaken in a fault. And thirdly, help bear someone else's burden. You're struggling even now. Don't bear it alone. Paul said, don't bear it alone. Bear ye one another's burden. Don't try to do it alone. Hear Jesus say, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon me and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your soul. That burden. Get someone, some other child of God, to pray with you. Look at the two verses again, and I'm finished. Galatians 6:1, brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, you which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. Bear ye one another's burdens, fulfill the law of God. bow for prayer.